नमस्ते डियर फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डिलाइटेड दैट द थर्ड एडिशन ऑफ संवाद इज टेकिंग प्लेस. द वर्ड संवाद मीन्स डायलॉग. दिस फोरम इज ए शेयर्ड डिजायर बिटवीन माय गुड फ्रेंड जापानीज पीएम शिंजो अबे and me. The aim is to promote people-to-people interactions that lead to conflict avoidance and environmental consciousness. I compliment the various individuals and think tanks who have initiated somewhat and made it grow. I am happy that this edition of Samvad is taking place in Ulaanbaatar in Mongolia. We in India consider Mongolia to be our spiritual friend, spiritual brother. The light of Buddhism started to shine in Mongolia centuries ago, thanks to monks who went there mainly from India. The distance or climate did not deter the spirit of these great monks. They became the earliest binding force between India and Mongolia. India-Mongolia friendship got a huge boost through the work of Kushok Bakula Rinpoche, who was India's ambassador in Mongolia from 1990 to 2000. Inspired by Lord Buddha, he lived not for himself, but for others. His numerous community service efforts touch lives across the world, and particularly in India and Mongolia. The Pethup Monastery that he established will be an enduring symbol of our links. In May last year, I had traveled to Leh, where I had joined the birth centenary celebration of the great Kushok Bakula Rinpoche. And earlier this year, I was again in Leh to lay the foundation of a modern airport, which is named after Kushok Bakula Rinpoche. Distinguished guests, I vividly remember my visit to Mongolia in 2015, the first prime ministerial visit to this beautiful nation. During that visit, I had the honor of addressing the Mongolian parliament. I can never forget my visit to the Ganden Monastery, where I had presented a Bodhi tree sapling to the Venerable Hamba Lama. I am told that a Buddha statue at the Ganden Monastery will be unveiled soon. This is one more symbol of our shared heritage. Friends, Samvad celebrates the ancient Asian philosophic values, which are best represented in the Hindu Buddhist civilizational streams. These values also serve as a guiding light to those ideologies that thrive on conflicts and hate. After all, conflict avoidance and openness are at the core of Hinduism and Buddhism. At the same time, this forum will also throw light on mitigating human conflicts with environment, which is facing great strain today. Distinguished guests, while I am addressing this distinguished gathering, it is natural to recall the noble teachings of Lord Buddha, which remain one of the greatest unifying forces in the world history. He not only brought people closer, but also furthered unity among societies that were in conflict with each other. Imagine the moral courage he had to walk up to one of the most dreaded dacoits of that time, Angulimal, and win him over just with the power of compassion and love. He was blessed with the power to go right in the midst of conflict and bring peace. Who can forget the manner in which he ensured peace between the Shakyam and the Koliyas? When Lord Buddha learned that these people were at war with each other, he was deeply anguished. He decided to go to these people and find the root cause of the conflict. When he asked why they were fighting, he got no clear answer for a long time. Eventually, he discovered that the fight was due to very little water. Lord Buddha wanted to know if there was indeed so much water to cause such a bitter conflict, more so when so many lives were at stake. The resounding answer was no. Lord Buddha asked the warring people to introspect on their deeds, considering that for a handful of water, so much blood would have flown. He also called for leading a life free from conflict. His powerful words were enough to bring both peace and sanity among those fighting. Distinguished guests, Lord Buddha did not approve of dividing society into fragments. He ensured that the principles of Buddhism were very clear in the rejection of violence and mindless hate. At the same time, he did not stop at just rejection. He also emphasized on serving society and eliminating every form of human suffering. After all, a world free from suffering would also mean a world free from conflicts. Friends, today my mind also goes back to another September. The September of 1893, when a saint from India beautifully articulated our contribution to the conflict avoidance. Yes, I am talking about Swami Vivekananda and his address at the World Parliament of Religions in Chicago. He did not agree with the conventional virtue of merely tolerating another faith, because that implied that one faith is inferior to another. He spoke about acceptance, which is steps ahead of mere tolerance. Swami Vivekananda advocated dialogue as a conflict avoidance model for differing faiths. The spirit of dialogue is not exclusive. It has ample space for other, often differing points of view. The moment we begin accepting the points of others and provide that space for debate as well as discussion, room for conflict disappears. Friends, I am proud to belong to the India that considers the world as our family. When we believe in this principle, we cannot even think about conflict. But in a time when parochial ideologies on the rise, our culture shows the way in balancing both national interests and global well-being. For this, we take inspiration from Mahatma Gandhi, who said, and I quote, "It is impossible for one to be internationalist without being a nationalist. Internationalism is possible only when nationalism becomes a fact, that is, when people belong to different countries, have organized themselves and are able to act as one man." Unquote. The wise Bapu Kaushan societies, seeking to profit at the cost of the other, and dreamt of an India that would work for humanity at large. 21st century India is doing precisely that. We are catering the national challenges along with a strong emphasis on making our world better. We see this spirit when India takes the lead with France in creating the International Solar Alliance to harness the rays of the sun for a better tomorrow. We see the spirit when the tiger population in India doubles in a span of 10 years, improving the balance of nature. We see the spirit when India is working towards eliminating single-use plastic. We also see the spirit in the efforts towards ensuring proper usage of water resources. India's success in this will touch the lives of 130 crore Indians, but will also help other nations of the world. Distinguished guests, care for the environment is also at the core of our vision of Vasudhaiv Kutumbakam. We are taught that nature is our own extension, and that is why we will take care of it in good times and bad. Friends, let us create a world free from mindless hate, violence, bloodshed, where we are all able to live together happily. Yes, there will be diversities and differences, but diversity is nothing but the plant of Mother Nature. It is Mother Nature who is manifesting herself in the form of these diversities. When we understand this diversity and accept this beauty, we will also understand that differences do not mean opposition. That is when urge for conflict will automatically drop. May also add that homogeneity is not only undesirable, but also boring. Our diversity strengthens us and make us vibrant and intellectually richer. May we celebrate this diversity, learn from each other, and leave behind a better planet for our future generations. Friends, I understand that a religious round table of all major world religions, intellectuals, and thinkers will be held parallelly as part of Samvad. This is a great effort. I wish the Samvad meet and the religious roundtable all success. Thank you all. Thank you very much. Namaste.